There are several models to explain the experimental results shown in the previous video and the general properties of nuclei, like their binding energies, structure, and so on and so forth. We are going to examine two of them more closely, starting from one that will allow us to analytically determine the mass and binding energy of the nucleus as a function of the mass and proton number. This model will also help us to understand why there are no stable nuclei with an arbitrary number of protons or neutrons, for instance, and why only certain combinations work. The so-called liquid drop model that we'll examine first is inspired by the similarities between these intermolecular interactions and nuclear forces. So just like a drop of water that is held together by the tension due to van der Waals forces, the nucleus is also held together by the nuclear force. We will try to reconstruct this empirical model by making some guesses about the nature of the different interactions at play. To start, let us first consider the nuclear force between nucleons, and let's assume that this force does not care about the type of nucleon, so it's the same between protons and protons, protons and neutrons, and neutrons and neutrons. Now, if we assume that all nucleons interact with each other via this force, then we would expect the binding energy to be something like the sum of the binding energies between each possible interacting pair. If there are A nucleons, then there are A times A minus 1 half pairs, right? So 2 nucleons, then 1 pair, 3 nucleons, then we have 3 pairs, 4 nucleons, we have 6 pairs, and so on and so forth. Now, in this case, A times A minus 1 halves for large numbers becomes roughly A squared. So then the binding energy also becomes proportional to A squared. Or equivalently, the binding energy per nucleon becomes proportional to A. But this is not what we observe, right? So we said that the binding energy per nucleon is maximum around iron or so, and then levels off or even decreases after that. Now, if we think about it, this implies that nucleons do not interact with every other nucleon. So if we drop the previous assumption and instead assume that each proton and neutron only interacts with a certain number of particles within a given range, so with a fixed number of neighbors, independently of how big the nucleus is, then the binding energy would depend linearly on the mass number, and so the binding energy per nucleon would be constant. So in this formula that we're trying to create to predict the binding energies, we could expect a volume term that is proportional to A, or equivalently, the volume of the nucleus. If we examine this assumption closely, we'll discover that nucleons that are near the surface do not have as many neighbors to interact with as particles in the center of the nucleus. This means that our formula so far overpredicts the binding energy. To correct for this, we need to subtract the term that is proportional to the surface, and because, as we saw earlier, the radius scales with the cube root of A, the surface will be the square of that, so proportional to A to the power of 2/3. To summarize, so far we have two terms, so the volume term that is proportional to the mass number, and the correction, the surface term, which is proportional to the surface, as the name implies, that is subtracted from the first. And the two proportionality constants, A and B, are to be determined later. Now, this is not the end of the story. And it's not the end of the story because thus far we have assumed that all nucleons interact only with the same force, or the nuclear force. However, protons, on top of that, have positive charges, so in addition, they feel the repulsion of other protons. Because the Coulomb potential does have an infinite range, in this case we would expect all protons to interact with each other. Therefore, we need a term that is proportional to z times z minus 1 halves, right? Because this is how many pairs of protons there are in the nucleus. In addition, the Coulomb potential falls with the inverse of the distance, which means that we need some component that is inversely proportional to the radius. So the bigger the radius, the larger the average distance between nucleons. So putting everything together, so far, we have a Coulomb term that is proportional to z times z minus 1 over a to 1/3 that needs to be subtracted because this force is repulsive and acts to break the nucleus. So the binding energy decreases. Unfortunately, we are not finished yet. That's because thus far we've only considered classical terms and have neglected quantum effects. But of course, nuclei are quantum systems with discrete energy levels, and this is of course reflected in their binding energies as well. The first quantum term we need to consider is related to the fact that protons and neutrons are fermions, and as fermions they obey the Pauli exclusion principle. If the nucleus has energy levels, then only two protons or two neutrons with opposite spins can fit in each level. Therefore, certain combinations of protons and neutrons will have a lower energy than other combinations with the same mass number. Let us examine this more closely. What we'll see now is not a rigorous derivation, but still useful to understand what is happening. First, let's make the assumption that all energy levels are equally spaced and protons and neutrons each occupy their own distinct shells. So they are different kinds of particles, so independent of each other. Let's also consider an asymmetry between neutrons and protons. For the sake of argument, let's say that there are a halves minus k protons and a halves plus k neutrons, where k is an integer. So if this is equal to zero, then one has the same number of neutrons and protons. If delta is the difference in energy between two subsequent levels, for the first, a halves minus k protons and neutrons will have four particles, so 2 plus 2 in the first level, four particles in the second level, and so on and so forth. So if we take this 4 delta as a common factor, then we have 4 times delta times 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus k halves terms. So with a bit of algebra, we find a term that is proportional to delta times k squared halves plus k. Now we have 2 times k extra neutrons to distribute to the remaining cells. Following a similar argument, we'll have 2 neutrons in the first level above the previous, 2 neutrons in the second level, and so on and so forth. So 2 times delta times 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus k terms, which is equal to delta times k squared plus k. The extra energy will therefore be proportional to the difference Exs minus E naught, which turns out to be equal to delta times k squared divided by 2. Now this delta, as we alluded to in the start, under the assumptions that we made, is inversely proportional to the mass number. So the more particles, the smaller the average difference between different states. And this asymmetry term k can be expressed in terms of the difference between nu and z. So at the end, we expect an asymmetry term that is proportional to n minus z squared over alpha. Again, I want to stress here that this is not a rigorous derivation, but in any case, it is useful to understand what is happening. To summarize, we again subtract an asymmetry term to penalize for the extra energy expected in asymmetric nuclei due to the Pauli exclusion principle. Finally, based on what we know from quantum mechanics, we expect pairs of neutrons or protons which couple to give a total spin of zero to have a somewhat lower energy than single protons and neutrons. Nuclei with even n and even z will have lower energy than odd-even nuclei, which in turn will have lower energy than odd-odd nuclei. So if we take the odd-even as a reference, then we can add a pairing term that is positive for even-even, zero for even-odd, and negative for odd-odd nuclei. And what we come up with, adding everything together, is the famous semi-empirical mass formula, which allows us to calculate the binding energy and mass for any combination of Z and N. Now, how do we determine these coefficients? To justify the name empirical, these coefficients are of course determined by fitting the experimental masses. So this plot here shows the predicted energy as a function of neutron and atomic number. So the light color in the middle represents high binding energy, so more highly bound nuclei, whereas the dark colors represent loosely bound nuclei. Perhaps not unexpectedly, the most stable nuclei are indeed located along this valley of stability that generally traces the Z equals to N line. In the next video, we'll discuss some limitations of this model and the need for a proper quantum mechanical description of the nucleus. In the last video, we'll see some practical applications of this liquid drop model.